Good afternoon and welcome to the Doha Institute. My name is Sultan Barakat and I'm the director of the newly established Center for Conflict and Humanitarian Studies here at the Doha Institute for Graduate Studies. This is our first public event and we have the pleasure of organizing it jointly with my former home, the Brookings Doha Center, one of the best think tanks in the world and certainly in the region. The present global landscape is marked by several economic, demographic, and political challenges whose causes and effects are not confined to national borders anymore and will therefore require greater political commitment and international coordination between world leaders. These challenges include a sluggish world economy affected by the falling global commodity prices, continuing population boom and mass urbanization, more frequent and severe conflicts and natural disasters, and which has resulted recently in the largest displacement crisis ever witnessed since the end of the Second World War, with almost 41 million people internally displaced and over 20 million people refugees today. And unfortunately, our region, and I'm talking here across including sub-Saharan Africa, all the way pushing into Pakistan and Afghanistan, has carried more than its fair share of those challenges. And it is for those reasons that we at the Doha Institute have decided to establish the Center for Humanitarian Conflict and Humanitarian Studies. The center aims to become a region leader for teaching and research on issues of conflict, state fragility, and humanitarian action in the Arab world. And only last week, we welcomed 24 exceptional master's students from 15 Arab countries, plus Ukraine and Pakistan, who are embarking on a two-year study with us, and who we hope will become the future leaders of development globally. Against the backdrop of the crisis we find ourselves in, the threats to global health, security, and economic stability have become ever more acute. Risks of the spread of infectious diseases endanger plans for development and drives development backward. As recently witnessed during the Ebola crisis in West Africa and the current Zika pandemic in Latin America. Both the Doha Institute and the Brookings Doha Center are very honored to collaborate today to offer a platform for one of the most distinguished practitioners and academics who for decades has provided indispensable global leadership to provide answers, well, first to raise questions, which was very important in her career, and to provide answers to some of those global challenges we face today. This afternoon, we have our distinguished speaker, Dr. Ngozi Okonjo-Iweala, who served twice as finance minister in Nigeria and was, of course, the first female finance minister, more recently between 2011 and 2015. In 2006, she became Nigeria's first female foreign minister and has also held several key positions globally, including at the World Bank, where she acted as the managing director. She serves on a host of boards for non-governmental organizations, and currently she is the chair of Gavi. And some of you would know Gavi as the organization that provides vaccine internationally, and it is made of the Vaccine Alliance Board. She is the author of several books, most recently Reforming the Unreformable, which was published by the MIT Press. We're very pleased to have Dr. Ngozi with us today, and we've agreed that she will share her thoughts with us for about 15 minutes, and then we'll engage in a conversation of a question and answer before taking some questions from the audience. The plan is to round up the whole discussion within an hour, And it is really just a taster to introduce you to the Dauha Institute and to our international work. And there's no better person than Dr. Ngozi to launch this interaction with our broader society. Please join us.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Barakat. And thanks to Dr. Yasser, both of you and all the people here for your leadership in this great, great institution. It's an honor and a pleasure to be here, first because I understand that I'm acting as a bridge builder between the Dauha Institute and the Brookings Dauha. Being the first to speak at a lecture that brings the two institutions together here. I also understand you opened up here the Center for Conflict and Humanitarian Studies just 2 weeks ago, and you moved into this fabulous facility. Again, this is perhaps the opening address of that. So what an honor to be the one to kick off, and I wish you the best of luck in the future. I want to start off, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, by thanking the government of Qatar. I know this is an academic thing, but I cannot but thank them because what brought me here, in addition to this lecture, was also to meet with members of the government, Her Highness Sheikh Amoza, the Minister of Health, we met earlier today, the Qatar Fund, because they have gone out of their way to try to support Gavi. They have joined, along with the many Gulf countries, and we are doing a tour of the Gulf. They've decided to support Gavi, the Global Alliance for Vaccines. And the reason they've done this is because they recognize one of the things that Dr. Barakat said, that we are now in a different situation globally, where vaccination and immunization is what I would call a global public good. This is something we all have to support because no longer are we isolated. If you don't take health care of the health, it's not just about taking care of the health of your children in your country or your citizens, but the neighboring countries matter. Because if you do not, what happens there could become a serious problem for you. It could become a serious problem globally, as we saw with the Ebola case and with Zika and MERS and SARS and all of the pandemics that threaten. So I owe them special thanks because they now have joined this global support for this broader global landscape. Investing in global issues, in global health, is fantastic because I believe that this is the way to go for the future because these types of issues will become increasingly critical in the year to come. As we face shifts in the global landscape, in the face of formidable seismic forces such as human migration, do what we can to stop it. I don't think we can completely succeed, so we have to contend with it. As we cope with climate change, urbanization, and all the other phenomena, the case for investment in global health will come, not just out of humanitarian need, but increasingly out of global economic necessity. And that is why I want to address you today on the issue of saving lives, saving economies. I talk about it with conviction because as a former finance minister, I focused very much on the economies part. But as I got involved more and more in the health field, I recognized that this lies at the heart of saving our economies. People will recognize that when they think of all what we've gone through globally in the various pandemics that I talked about. So I'll talk a little bit about global health and a bit about the costs and the benefits of investing in global health, the value of vaccines. I want to talk to you a little bit about the Gavi model because you may not be familiar with it, the story so far, and use this as a means of weaving together, you know, what it means and what benefits we get from saving lives and saving economies. The term global health is often thought of as being synonymous with doing the right thing. It conjures notions of protecting the vulnerable, improving the lives of those most in need, and addressing gross inequities. While all these remain true, recent years have taught us that global health also means much more. Outbreaks of MERS, I think it's called Corona, Ebola and Zika have demonstrated, sometimes with brutal ferocity, that infectious disease can be as destructive and disruptive as armed conflict. Despite all that modern medicine has to offer, viral outbreaks remain a continuous threat to global health security and to economic stability across the world. Because in addition to the cost in human lives, there can be huge knock-on effects to infrastructure and trade, and broader impacts in the form of demand shocks to trade and service industries. It is not just the diseases we need to worry about. The fear and uncertainty that comes with a viral outbreak can be as contagious as the virus itself. And like disease, it's by no means confined to where an outbreak just takes place. This means we are all vulnerable, no matter how well protected we might think we are. Gulf states tend to have exemplary track records in protecting their people from infectious disease, often with childhood immunization rates close to 100%, like that of the developed countries. But even that is not enough. As I said earlier, if your neighbor is at risk, then one way or the other, so too are you. As Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. once put it, whatever affects one directly affects all indirectly. In short, if we want to ensure global health security and avoid global economic instability, then we need to protect everyone, no matter where they live. I really want this lesson to sink in. We need to protect everyone, no matter where they live. Consider the evidence. With Ebola, the economic impact on Guinea, Liberia, and Sierra Leone, the three worst hit countries, was estimated at $2.8 billion. For Zika, the figure is even higher. An optimistic estimate for the localized impact of the virus in Latin America and the Caribbean puts the cost at $3.5 billion for 2016 alone. And when you take these measures as percentages of the income or GDP of, let's say, the Guinea, Sierra Leone, and Liberia, you see that this is very significant. In my country, let me speak personally on the Ebola, we were very lucky, because Nigeria is a country of almost 180 million people. And what happened? Ebola was not endemic. It didn't start there. It started with one case of an official traveling from Liberia to Nigeria for a conference for the Economic Community of West African States. And he arrived at the airport and became sick. He used his telephone to call his ambassador. That telephone was lent to him by somebody, and the person who lent him the phone got the disease. He was taken to a clinic, and a very clever female doctor, who is a heroine in Nigeria today, thought something beyond malaria, because he said he had malaria, thought something beyond malaria was wrong. And she kept him there against his wishes and put him on a drip, ran a test. Luckily, in Nigeria, we have the labs. This was one of the problems in Guinea, Sierra Leone, and Liberia. They didn't have the labs for the test, so it took longer. We had the lab, and within a couple of days, the result came out. But by then, three or four more people had been infected. But because we had a stronger health system than the other countries, we were able to use that system, established with the help of Gavi, which is why I'm an enthusiast of Gavi today. Gavi, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, we had a system for polio. We used that system to track those who were infected and the contacts they had. And that way, we were able to limit the cases to 19, of which 8 deaths, and to shut the pandemic down. Imagine if a country of 180 million with so many travelers had not done this, the world could have been a worse place. So I'm speaking to you from experience of having this happen and having had it very scary but successfully dealt with in my own country. So we are looking at this and counting the cost. When we look at Ebola and so on and Zika, we are talking about local impacts. For these viral outbreaks, it's too early to know what the broader economic effects will be. However, if we look a little further back, we can get a sense. Between 2002 and 2003, an outbreak of SARS, or severe acute respiratory syndrome, spread from China to 37 countries, infecting more than 8,000 people and killing 774 of them. The cost for 2003 alone, it cost US $54 billion in global GDP loss. Then there's the Middle East respiratory syndrome. Since 2012, of the 1,800 or so MERS cases, of which 640 resulted in death, the vast majority were in Saudi Arabia and the Arabian Peninsula. While the risk of infection is relatively low for MERS, as was the economic impact of this outbreak, the possibility of a more infectious strain mutating represents a real threat to the region. Not least the US $12 billion a year generated in tourism as a result of the Hajj and Umrah. And I must here also commend the government of Saudi Arabia because they have strongly supported Gavi. They are also one of the states that have come in, and in fact, in 2 days' time, we'll be signing an agreement with them for support to Gavi to help deal with these threats. Typically, the natural reaction to these kinds of threats is to focus efforts on protecting oneself from the disease itself. However, even this is fraught with challenges. Viruses already have little regard for borders, but now the scale and speed of human migration could potentially make outbreaks even more difficult to contain. With nearly 1 billion people migrating internally or internationally each year, whether they be economic migrants, on holy pilgrimage to the Hajj, or fleeing conflict in Yemen or Syria, the world is decidedly much smaller than it used to be. Today, it is possible to travel from Nairobi to London and New York, all in less time than it can take for someone to develop symptoms of a viral infection. Border security and immigration control will only get us so far. If we want to keep the bugs at bay instead, we need to look at how we can prevent outbreaks in the first place. And that means investing in global health, ensuring that a child living in poverty in a remote rural village or an urban slum has the same access to vaccines, to nutritional supplements, to sanitation as children in Saudi Arabia or Qatar. That's the challenge we face. This is, of course, the right thing to do, the humanitarian thing to do. After all, health is a fundamental human right. But in addition to this, what may sometimes be forgotten or overlooked is that investing in global health, investing in that child, is also the smart thing to do. Because the threat posed by disease is not just to human life, it's a threat to society, stability, and ultimately to economic growth. The good news is that we already have a solution, vaccines. Not only are this extremely cost-effective health intervention, but one that has already played a hugely positive role in global health security, with the eradication of smallpox in 1980. In the 20th century alone, smallpox killed between 300 to 500 million people, leaving many of its survivors blind or disfigured. The annual savings brought about by its eradication is believed to be in excess of US $1 billion in terms of the direct cost of vaccination and quarantine. But the full impact on global economies is simply incalculable. And here's why. In addition to preventing illness and death, immunization can have an extremely positive impact on a nation's economy. A vaccinated infant is less likely to require medical treatment and care, both of which come at a cost. And by avoiding illness, they have a greater chance of growing into a healthy child who is able to attend school and ultimately become a more productive member of society. Meanwhile, instead of caring for a sick child, Their parents are in a better position to go out to work, increasing their earning capacity, which feeds back into the local and national economy. So by preventing disease, vaccination can, in a very real sense, can and does, in a very real sense, contribute to the economy. Let me also here emphasize that the intersection of education and health in the well-being of our children and the strength of our economies is paramount. And that is why working multisectorally, as we are trying to do with the Sustainable Development Goals, can have a really greater impact than working on one alone. This is well recognized here in Qatar by Sheikh Hamoza in her education work. As Her Highness said in a recent speech, quote, "We cannot overcome our healthcare challenges unless we begin to invest in solutions that link health and education, as they are intrinsically connected. And innovation in education leads us to innovation in health. It is our wish to promote the cost of both access to basic primary education and universal health coverage." We couldn't agree more, as we see increasingly in the work we're doing that the intersection of these two sectors and the ability to work with the two together will yield much greater impact. Now, regarding vaccines, a recent study published in the journal Health Affairs has gone some way to quantify the returns. Looking at 94 low and middle-income countries, the researchers found that for every dollar invested in childhood immunization, we can expect to save $16 in healthcare costs, lost wages and productivity due to illness. If you take into account the full value people place on living longer, healthier lives, then the return on investment increases even further to $44. But then, if immunization has such an important role to play and is such a good investment, why not simply immunize every child on the planet? I'll come to that. But I want to emphasize the returns that I just spoke about. There are very few investments quantified that can yield you the kinds of returns we talk about. $1 yielding $16 in avoided costs and $44 if you add broader benefits. So why not simply immunize every child? Here, let me talk about the Gavi model. One reason is that until a few years ago, this would have been unimaginable. Towards the end of the 20th century, despite great progress, immunization rates were stagnating. In developing countries, preventable infectious diseases were still killing many children because they were not receiving even the most basic vaccines. At the same time, new life-saving vaccines were becoming available for some of the biggest killers of children, but they were not reaching poor countries because they were simply too expensive. This led to global health champions coming together to create what is today Gavi, the Vaccine Alliance, a unique and innovative global health organization designed with the specific task of improving access to vaccines for the world's poorest children, and an organization of which I'm very proud to say I'm the board chair. As Nelson Mandela, the founding board chair and one of the original inspirations of Gavi, put it, quote, "Life or death for a young child too often depends on whether he or she is born in a country where vaccines are available or not," unquote. Gavi and its partners seek to end this through a unique public-private sector partnership that brings together developing countries, UNICEF, the World Health Organization, the World Bank, Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, along with donor countries such as the UK, the US, Germany, the Gulf countries, of which Qatar is one, and I could go on and on. It also brings on board vaccine manufacturers, the private sector, civil society, all around one table within a sustainable governance model. It is a model that has proved incredibly successful, with 40% of the world's children now receiving vaccines with Gavi support. Global coverage of routine immunization has increased to more than 80%, and as a result, childhood mortality has fallen. Indeed, Gavi is just 15 years old and has helped vaccinate more than 500 million children, 580 million children, thus preventing 7 to 8 million deaths in the process. All this has been achieved partly by giving poor countries access to the same vaccines that are available in wealthy nations, but at an affordable price. To fully immunize a child in the US would cost roughly $950 in vaccines alone. Yet, through Gavi, the same vaccines are made available to low-income countries for just $35. And that's because we use our alliance and our power to bargain and negotiate and offer volume, and we're able to bring it down. At the same time, we have seen the speed at which new vaccines reach poor countries increase, such as those that prevent pneumonia and diarrhea, the two biggest killers of under fives, and even vaccines that prevent cancer. But it's still not enough. Currently, one in five children in Gavi-supported countries are still not getting access to the most basic vaccines. And despite progress in reducing child mortality, we still see 1.5 million children die every year from vaccine-preventable diseases. Because of this, Gavi is now accelerating efforts to increase coverage and improve equity, with the ambitious goal of reaching an additional 300 million children by 2020, therefore preventing another 5 to 6 million more deaths in the process. Gavi's success is critical, but not just from a humanitarian point of view. Ensuring that all children are protected, no matter where they live, is both the right thing to do, but also what is necessary. If we want to have global health security, then we must reach every last child, which will be no small undertaking. Reaching that fifth child, the one in five that is still missing out, will be difficult enough, particularly given that they represent the hardest children to reach. But in addition to this, there are further pressures that are shifting the global health landscape, and in doing so, challenging our efforts and threatening global health and economic security in the process. We are increasingly discovering that many of the hardest to reach children exist not just in remote rural communities, but in the heart of cities, living off the grid in marginalized urban communities. With population levels set to rise to nearly 10 billion by 2050, where more than two-thirds of the world population will live in urban settings, we can expect more and more of these marginalized communities to end up in cities, hiding in plain sight. In terms of global health security, such communities represent a significant blind spot in the prevention of urban epidemics. Our ability to reach these communities will only get harder as urban density increases, and it will. Along with population growth, additional pressures will drive more and more people towards the cities. Desertification is expected to displace 60 million people between 2014 and 2020, with as many as 200 million more people becoming permanently displaced environmental migrants. Land degradation, rising sea levels, famine or conflict mean more and more people will be competing for less land, with one consequence: cities are likely to swell. This could have dire consequences for global health security. The combination of more people living in less space and placing more strain on already limited sanitation represents a fertile breeding ground for infectious disease and the insects that spread them. At the same time, the sheer scale of cities has the potential to overstretch vaccine supplies, limiting our ability to prevent or respond to outbreaks. We have already seen this recently with the largest yellow fever outbreak in decades in cities in Angola and DRC recently. Let me then conclude by saying, ultimately, what we need is a complete reassessment of the way in which immunization is viewed. Yes, it's about saving lives and preventing needless suffering. But yes, it is also about saving economies. When I talk of investing in vaccination, I mean this in every sense of the word: an investment in the lives of children, an investment in helping families, communities, and nations pull themselves out of poverty, an investment in making the world safer, and an investment in global economic stability and growth. Gavi has been working hard towards this end, but in the face of global economic downturn and tightening aid budgets, The need for additional investment in childhood immunization has never been more critical. Immunization is already recognized by global leaders as an important part of the Sustainable Development Goals. But it also needs to be viewed differently as a global health security priority. Without equity, there can be no global health security. Or if I may quote from the Quran, chapter 5, verse 32, quote, "And whoever saves one life, it is as if he has saved entire mankind." Let me say amen to that. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Well, thank you so much for this wonderful exploration of what is a very complex issue. And I think what really struck me is the direct link you made between vaccination and the economic impact of it. And the figures you've given, it shows clearly that for a fraction of that, we could avoid getting into that situation where billions and billions of dollars are lost in global economies.
Absolutely.
In terms of the way we look at it from our region, I mean, clearly we're very pleased to see that the Gulf countries are playing a small part in supporting Gavi. But we are increasingly living in a situation where states' role is shrinking. Mm-hmm. We have countries in the Arab world where state fragility has become the rule. And there are areas that are inaccessible. And of course, vaccination then becomes much more difficult to implement, and immunization campaigns and so on. I don't know if you have any particular view on that, whether Gavi is working on a strategy to address conflict-affected countries, and particularly in terms of access to those communities that are trapped within the conflict.
That's a very important question. And a very critical one. Actually, Gavi has a fragility policy, which we are reviewing as we speak. And hopefully we'll come back to the board at our December meeting. What we're trying to do is look at this to see how we can be more flexible in handling situations of fragility. Already, we have a case in point in Yemen, where we are working with our partners. UNICEF and WHO are parts of this alliance. And on the ground, it was became very difficult with the conflict to try and reach people to immunize. And yet, every party in the conflict, we are very fortunate, recognizes that this is absolutely critical. So from a situation where almost up to half of the facilities where we could not use, recently we've been able to restore the use of the facilities where the vaccines are stored or move them to safer areas where they do not spoil. And I'm happy to say that I think we are 75% covering 75% of the areas of the children we need to cover. We are not yet in 25%, we're not able. But we've restored much of the services, and we're also doing it using mobile vaccination clinics and following people where they go. So that's the adaptation we need to look at. What do we need to put in place? Also issues of, we work using a cutoff because not all every country is Gavi eligible. If you have income of about $1,580 per capita and above, you may not be Gavi eligible. You're deemed able to take care of most of your needs and so on. So we have cutoff points, but we are reviewing that as well because two reasons. Some of the countries that are well off are in conflict. Syria is a case in point. Libya is another case in point. And what do we do in those particular countries? Their per capita income may fall, or even if they are well off, they are not able to organize. So these are some of the issues we are looking at. Some of the richer countries we work in also fall in and out, like when they are impacted by a commodity downturn, they experience a fall. What do you do? How do you support them over the interim? So for all these reasons, we are reviewing what we can do to help.
Right. In a previous life, I used to spend a lot of time in Somalia. And I was struck that the main obstacle for good campaigns of vaccination is the absence of fridges at the village level. You go around village after village after village, and they don't have the fridge, they can't keep the vaccine, and therefore they rely on vaccination that is quite random whenever the campaign happened to be around. They cannot do it systematically for children. And all it takes is a solar power panel. And that small investment is still not there. And ironically, I was talking the other day to a colleague from Yemen. He's saying, in Yemen now, they're innovating. They're coming up with solar panels, as did the people in Gaza because of their isolation. Now, those small initiatives that have been taken on the ground to try and make sure that vaccine is available continuously, what role do you think the global community should do to help?
The Gavi, the alliance, is actually playing a very important role in supporting some of these small efforts that you see in trying to use, you know, adaptable technology. And I tell you one thing, we've just launched a big initiative on a cold chain platform. We've just opened up because we realized this problem, we've realized it. But in addition to that, even countries, the existing cold chain equipment is falling apart, is obsolete or needs to be renewed. And what we're saying is let us use appropriate technology or available technology. Let's innovate where we can. And it very much includes using solar, little fridges that are solar powered, little packs, cold packs that are solar powered. And I've seen this in action. I was in a clinic in Ethiopia where they had one of these. So we are promoting that. This new platform, we're in fact mobilizing even additional resources to support it. We think we need $300 million to reach all our countries. Gavi is putting in maybe, we've put in an initial 50 and maybe another one. And we are trying to get our donors to support. So yes, you're absolutely right. And I'll tell you the other thing that's exciting about Gavi. We really try to innovate. In Rwanda, for example, with the government in the lead, we've worked with the private sector, a company called Zipline and DHL, to use drones to deliver vaccines and blood, save blood to high, you know, it's a very hilly and mountainous country, and driving roads up there is very expensive. So now we are using these drones to deliver vaccines, deliver blood and other supplies up there. So where we can innovate with most recent technology, with adaptable technology, we are doing that.
Right, thank you so much. And if I may just ask a couple of extra additional questions, and then we'll go back to the audience. In terms of global governance of the whole issue of vaccine, and you mentioned pharmaceutical being on your board and so on, but are they governed in any way, or is it like herding cats? You have to go around trying to bring them all in one direction. If you recall when we had the flu, the bird flu, those who can afford it bought a lot of that vaccine and brought it into their countries. They didn't necessarily use it all. And those who couldn't afford it, they were left behind. And then later on, some donations helped them acquire some vaccine, but maybe it arrived after the disease had passed on. Is there a body that governs that relationship?
Well, I was smiling at the notion of herding cats because I'm chair of the board, and anybody who is on boards or chairs knows sometimes it's very difficult and can be like herding cats.
I'm sure.
But I think I'm very fortunate that the Gavi board, even though it has this public-private partnership, works very well. It's very good governance, I have to say that. But to answer your question, the WHO, you know, governs this relationship, you know, in deciding what vaccines should be further developed, where, how should they be stocked, which one is ready, not ready. And WHO is part of the alliance. So we very much rely on their judgment when it comes to human vaccines. For example, just recently they did a protocol to look at which new vaccines should companies be working on. As you know, It doesn't, most of these are very costly to develop. So it's not really cost effective for them. So you have to find means. I'm happy to say that in the protocol, MERS, the Middle East Respiratory Syndrome, has been identified as one of those for which the WHO will launch the work. But where Gavi comes in is to say, look, we know it's costly to develop these things. Developing countries cannot afford. So, but if we can guarantee you volume, since we work worldwide, we will purchase such volume that in the end, you'll be able to make some money back, you know, this encourages companies to go into this area, do the research that is needed that they otherwise would not do. And we also encourage companies to stockpile. I'm very proud that one of the things Gavi did recently is in January of this year is with, to pay, negotiate with Merck just a reasonable cost amount to cover their cost, and so to stockpile 300,000 doses of Ebola vaccine. 300,000. You remember, all of you will remember what happened when there was the Ebola crisis. You remember there were these few doses left, experimental, and then there was this arbitrary deciding who would get it and leave, who would not get it. It was, for me, one of the most painful sights to watch the world going through this. And I'm very proud that Gavi, we decided this must not happen again. The WHO has approved this vaccine. The EU authorities, we're waiting for the US is going. They take a long, but we decided if it has been approved by this, let us get a stockpile. Let's pay for it. So that if it ever comes out again, we will not have to sit as a global community watching people die needlessly. Isn't that something to be proud of? I'm proud of it. And that's the kind of work that Gavi does and can do.
Thank you. And the last question from my side is on the private sector. I know they play a very important role in this. And we established that they're kind of governed by WHO, but WHO does not hold them accountable. Do you see any difference between private sector that is rising in countries like India, Brazil, maybe Jordan is one of the largest in the region in terms of pharmaceutical production. Is the attitude different from those that are established in Europe and North America, or is the same attitude all running after the profit?
Well, no, I would not say what I've encountered, and I've sat with the CEOs of these organizations, both from, we actually have on the board, this is very interesting, the representative of the pharmaceuticals for developing countries. And then we have the representative for developed, because the developed country manufacturers, the big ones like Novartis, GlaxoSmithKline, you know, and so on, and Merck, the developing countries, India, China, and all that, they feel that it's so hard to compete with these people. They need their own chair on the board, and we've done that. So there's actually competition, and that ability to negotiate down a dose of vaccine to $35 is because manufacturers from the developing countries are producing those who have been at lower prices. So we're able to get them to compete with each other, but they've not exhibited that it's the bottom line only. I have to be very fair to them. You know, I think there's a recognition that it's more than the bottom line in some of these things. Yes, profit counts, and we recognize they have to make something. You know, so we have to allow for a little bit of cost plus. But they recognize that if you allow these pandemics to take place, if you do not prepare, they too are at risk. The world is at risk. So there's a very much a sense of responsibility when you see them on the board. And I want to commend them for that from what I've seen. It hasn't been just this profit motive only.
Great. Well, thank you so much. That's very reassuring. With this very positive response, I'll open the floor for questions. Please. You need to speak to the microphone because of the translation.
Yes, thank you very much. My name is Rinald Staring. I work for the Hague Institute for Global Justice. In a previous life, I've introduced also the access to medicine to the WISH conference here 2 years ago. And my question is, my compliment to you is that you managed to lower these access to medicine prices to $35. It's a tremendous achievement. The access to medicine index is also supporting all these initiatives. And my question to you is, do you have a relationship with them, I guess? Are they on the board, or have you ever heard of them? They are from Holland, and they established this index by which the pharmaceuticals are held to lower their access to medicines.
What's their name again?
Access to Medicine Index.
Access to Medicine. Faisal, do you know about them? Because I don't know about them personally, and I've not encountered them. But let me tell you, we have on the board I presume they're a non-profit.
Absolutely.
Yeah, so I will have to check, because represented on the board of Gavi is civil society, and there are more than 120 members of that civil society group. So they got together and elected someone to represent them. So it could well be that they're one of the 120. I just don't know. I will check.
Just to add, they're also supported by the Bill Gates Foundation.
Foundation. Then they may very well be, because, you know, Bill Gates is the Gates Foundation, sorry, is the second largest donor to Gavi with about $1.5 billion.
Thank you.
Thank you. Please.
Thank you for your valuable comments and presentation. My question to you is, you mentioned that there is a cutoff point for countries to be eligible for Gavi. However, we know that there are many countries which suffer from inequality. So you see a big portion of the population below the poverty line or in healthcare coverage. So how do you deal with that?
Well, this is a very tough question for us, because you're absolutely right. You can have within a country what I call two or three economies. You can have a per capita income, an economy with a per capita income of $5,000, and within the same country you find even $500 or $600. You know, even within many of the countries on my continent, etc., you find that. India is a case in point. So it becomes very difficult, because you look at provinces like Bihar, for instance, and so on, and you know that the per capita income does not compare. What we've tried to do is very tough. We are operating in some of these countries precisely because of some of these arguments that we've been able to make to convince the board that some of the middle-income countries actually contain some of the poor, the largest number of poor people in the world, in sheer numbers. Mm. So it is very difficult to just say, on that basis, let's not operate. So we can operate in some of these states and provinces. But it's a tough sell, because the demand is so high. We are still in India in spite of everything. We are in some other countries. But what we are doing is we make them pay a higher co-financing amount. You know, so we make countries join in the financing, so nobody gets everything free. And Gavi is one of the institutions trying to work itself out of a job by saying to certain countries, even if we are with you, when you get to a certain point, you have to take over your immunization. And we, between now and 2020, we're expecting 20 countries out of the 73 to fully phase out. And we will support them by making sure they have access to low-cost vaccines, but no longer be co-financing. So we are doing some of that with these countries, edging them out gradually.
Great, thank you so much. I promise you that we will keep this for an hour. And I also know Dr. Ugozi has a flight to catch. So we'll take two last questions. My colleague, Dr. Hassan.
Just an extension to what Dr. Youssef mentioned here for the per capita income as the measure, with all of the defects in an average, as economists, and I know that you know about this, probably taking one of the more qualitative and physical kind of indicator like infant and child mortality might be a better, in this case, proxy for the countries. I have also a question about your great efforts in terms of the eradication of diseases for children. Everybody used in previous life, so I would use in previous life. I was interested also in infant and child mortality. And it seemed like in Africa specifically, the waterborne disease seemed to be the most important factor in causing infant and child mortality. So in addition to the vaccination, the root causes should be also dealt with in some fashion. So I wonder if your organization has anything to do with the sanitation, bringing water, clean water, to the poor people in this case. Thank you.
I think those are just two excellent questions or comments. The first one, I couldn't agree with more. We all know the defects of per capita income. It's just that when you're working, you look for some kind of indicator that is simple enough, you know, accepted by the global community. But we do look at other factors. Just as we are not so doctrinaire when it comes to a country with very poor states, we do look at some of these indicators and factor them into account. Because again, you have middle-income countries who may have a high-looking per capita income, and then you look and you find certain indicators that just don't work. You know, some human development indicators are not good at all. And I think that even in my country, you have a case like that, you know, where certain human development indicators, maternal mortality, in fact, certainly did improvement. And you cannot say, let's just abandon these countries. So we take some of that into account. It's not as sharp as I made it sound. On the second issue, you're really speaking to something which we spent, today's entire morning actually talking to Her Highness Sheikha Moza, who is very interested in these multi-sectoral approaches. And this was precisely her point, that in doing her work on education, she finds that health is important, sanitation is important, and she was asking, how do we get into this multi-sectoral? And I told her this is absolutely right. In fact, when I was a finance minister, and the Minister of Health sometimes would say, the budget is not, you're not giving us enough budget, I would say, but we've just increased the budget for water and sanitation, because if we can get clean water, you know, it will take care of the diarrhea and then we won't have. So you're very right, and it's always a question of balance. But how does Gavi deal with this? Gavi decided, along with the partners, that strengthening of health systems is a very important part of delivery of the vaccination. So we don't just stop at vaccines. We are now working in the health system strengthening area with all the whole partnership. What do we mean by this? Then we are looking at the delivery, the equipment and cold chain, the water along the way, even the personnel. Are they adequate and fit, and do we have enough to even deliver what we need? And I think that it's this kind of more multi-sectoral approach. It's very hard. When you talk of strengthening health system, it sounds very nice and glib and easy. Not at all. You know, it is hard work. And that's what we're trying to do. But I tell you why I think it's critical, because that's what saved us in my country from the Ebola pandemic, because we had established a system with personnel, people, tracing, data that could deliver. So you're absolutely right. That's what we are, in the partnership with Qatar, we are going to be working on this multi-sectoral approach.
I promised you one last question, but I have to adjust that with your permission to one last round of few questions. So what we'll do is we'll take a round of few questions. There are three or four. Please.
Okay, thank you so much. My name is Okpadija Jalili. I'm a reporter with Qatar Tribune newspaper. I just want Madam to clear one point. Making vaccines available is one point. Clearing misconception about what debar people from taking vaccines or vaccination is another thing. Is Gavi doing anything in promoting awareness? In certain countries like Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nigeria, there are conceptions that, no, we're not allowed vaccination for this, for that. Is Gavi doing anything in promoting awareness?
Okay, thank you very much. So there's a point about awareness. Please, the gentleman with the red tie.
Thank you so much for your presentation. My name is Fadl Abdelghani. I'm the chairman of Syrian Network for Human Rights. I'm really enthusiastic about if you have any estimation or what Gavi doing in Syria. Syria is extraordinary situation, especially in the besieged area. We have 2.2 million under besieged area, mainly by the Assad regime, which is targeting the UN convoy in 19 of September, this previous September. So how you are dealing, and this is part actually from Dr. Sultan, first question, how you are dealing with this extraordinary conflict in particular
right,
in Syria?
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Okay. Please, can you bring the microphone? Okay, take that question on the way as well, please, that one.
Hello, everyone. Thank you very much first for this fruitful and beneficial discussion. Actually, I am Zakaria Bakhush from studying in Doha Institute in Political Sciences and International Relations. I am as well youth advisor to UNFPA. Actually, we traveled to a lot of countries, especially in Sudan, in Eritrea, Ethiopia, working on the same field, vaccines and medical field. My question is, how can we work of an agreement between UNFPA, United Nations Populations Unfound, and with Gavis for a better cooperation? Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll take a question here with the blue tie, and then I'll come back to you.
Thank you. My name is Emmanuel Lamy. I'm from the Embassy of Liberia in Doha. Firstly, Dr. Okonjo-Miradi, may I extend my thanks to you for the wonderful presentation. I would like to inquire as to the program of Gavi as it relates to health workers. For example, in Liberia, Sierra Leone, and Guinea, most of our health workers died because there were no orientation about Ebola and never been in our region. So do you have a program to work with the health curriculum so that the as health workers are being trained, they will have an idea what to work with upon graduation?
Great. Thank you. I'm afraid we've got to stop. I know it's a very interesting subject.
Well, let's take the gentleman that had his hand up for so long. Yes.
Dr. Zakaria.
Yeah.
Hello. Thank you, Sultan. Your Excellency, you mentioned that there are vaccination is not going to eliminate plagues in Africa. Maybe we have Ebola, we have AIDS, we have malaria. In Egypt only, 18 million, 20% of population are infected with virus C. I think this needs a very big allocations. Charity will not be sufficient. In Egypt, education, health, research, only 4.7 from the budget, while defense and army taking 50%. My opinion, in order to eliminate all diseases, we have to fight despotism, corruption in our country, and then we will be in no need to treat any more diseases. Thank you.
Great, thank you so much.
Okay.
So we have 5 points. Yeah. One on public awareness and maybe cultural practices and refusal of vaccination. Syria, the relationship between UNFPA and Gavi, the idea of developing health curriculum, and switching away from charitable action to something more developmental investment.
Well, I'm going to not do it alone. I have my colleague Faisal here, who is in charge of the Middle East. So I'm going to ask him to take two of the questions and add his voice. Why don't you talk about what we're doing? Because he's from Pakistan, that's why I want him to answer. I'm from Nigeria, so I could also answer from that point. But please answer about the awareness programs. It's a very important point that the gentleman raised. And also, at the same time, what we're doing with the program of health workers that His Excellency from the Embassy of Liberia raised. He raised the issue, what does Gavi do with training of health workers and raising the awareness about how to deal with some of these diseases because of the number of health workers that died during Ebola, if I got you correctly. Yeah.
So thank you very much. So a couple of points on Syria. Syria still has a high income. We don't have the latest economic indicators. So we were approached by Arab League in 2013 to support. So directly we could not, because we have to follow some of our, unfortunately, procedures. But we brought together UNICEF, WHO, and Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation to come up with a program, and they are supporting immunization in camps and wherever they could inside Syria as well. So that program is ongoing. And as Dr. Ngozi mentioned earlier, we are working on revising our fragility policy, relaxing it a little bit, and hopefully Syria might become, in December we will know, on 8 December we will precisely know if Syria become eligible to Gavi support. So we are fully in touch and working on that. In terms of advocacy, Gavi is, in November last year, we became member of Steering Health Committee of OIC, Organization of Islamic Cooperation. And the whole idea was how we engage with some of these institutions in the region on dissemination of some of these issues, vaccine is haram or vaccine is causes this or that effect, which is, I believe, scientifically wrong. So Islamic Development Bank and OIC have done series of conferences and events in the region for Afghanistan, Pakistan, Nigeria, Sudan, and we work very, very closely with them. In fact, on Thursday, we met OIC and IDB in Jeddah, and we have reiterated to how we expand that partnership and go and do more work to tell people that how vaccines work and how they should take it more seriously. In terms of, I think, health training workers, I'm not sorry to say authority on how we did in Ebola, but under our health system strengthening program, so this is one of the biggest component, how we train health workers in the countries we support. That's part of our health system strengthening initiative.
So let me take the other questions then. I think on the issue of UNFPA and Gavi, UNFPA is not part of the alliance, but it's part of the United Nations. And therefore, we try to coordinate with them. But I think we need to do more, because they are not a systematic part of the alliance. So it's a good point. We'll take that back and see what we can do to improve that. With regard to the issue of charity, I couldn't agree more in the sense that I also strongly believe, and this is not a Gavi thing, I'm speaking as someone from a developing country, I believe that the immunization of our children is such a top priority that it should feature very firmly in our budgets. That way we are not talking about charity. That is my belief. And this is something we are trying to promote. So Gavi doesn't just work on let us wait for donations. We also do two or three different things. One is to insist that a country must contribute something, because one day they have to take over. Gavi is not going to be there forever. And as I said, we already have 20 countries scheduled to phase out. And I support it strongly. One of the reasons I came on board as chair is because I believe in this, that it should be one of the first things that we pay for in our own budget. It should not just depend on donations. So some countries are very poor now, they're in conflict, we have to help them, but along the way. So that takes us away from charity. That's what makes it sustainable. The second thing, though, is that Gavi does not work solely on charity. We also use some mechanisms to raise money on the capital markets. I don't know if you know that Gavi raises money on the capital markets and tries to bring in an element of financing. I'm quick to confess that this is on the back of the support of the donors, but it's a different way. It's not just waiting for them to hand out the money. What we do is we say, okay, we have people who back us, but we can't wait. Sometimes they give us 100 million this year, 20 million the next year. We want to save lives now. We want countries to become sustainable sooner. So we want to front load money and work now. How can we do it? So using this backing, we go on the capital markets. We have something called IFIM, the International Finance Facility for Immunization. We go on the capital markets and we raise money. We are targeting 6.5 billion and we've raised about more than 5 billion now to work to pay for health systems, for vaccines, for strengthening countries now so that they can take over sooner. And what happens is, 20 years' time, when the bond is retired, because these are more long-term, a country that wants to support Gavi can retire the bond at that time, but we use the money now. So that is a very different way of thinking. So Gavi is very sharp with innovative mechanisms, and this is one way of also trying to get us off the charity and donation route all the time.
Well, thank you so much. I'm sure.
Oh, sorry, I forgot to mention. Sorry. Wants me to mention the Sukuk. Part of this raising, we have the Sukuk bonds that we raised 700 million recently in the region. About 60% of it was subscribed to in this region. And a Qatari bank, what's the name of the bank? Bawa Bank, participated as a lead organizer. And it was very popular, 1.6 times oversubscribed in the region, and we will raise more. In Japan, individual people buy these bonds. They are called vaccine bonds, and they are very popular. So anyone who wants to do good and do well, please invest in vaccine bonds.
Well, thank you so much, and thank you for investing your time. Thank you for investing your time with us. And please, as you battle with these issues, do feel free to come back to us for research partnership on some of those important issues. At the Doha Institute, we have, I think, without exaggerating, some of the best minds on development economics, public administration, state fragility, conflict. We'll be very, very happy to work with Gabby on some of those issues. Thank you all for participating today with us. There will be a light reception outside, so please feel free to join us, and we'll have more chance to say hello to each other. This applies to everyone except for our students, who I can see Dr. Ibrahim is anxiously standing there in the corner. He's late for his lecture. So those who are doing our course, you have to skip the reception and straight onto the class. Oh, everyone else is welcome to join us.
I wish I could join your class if I was not going to. I love the young people.
Thank you very much. Thank you.